So I'm going to talk about a few of my hobby horses today. First, rates of return to agricultural R&D. I think even the skeptics have accepted now that agricultural R&D does generate high rates of return, very high rates of return. And they don't always reach the obvious conclusion from that, which is that we're underinvesting. And so that's something just to carry around with you, that if you buy that the rate of return to agricultural research is high, as we say, then that means we're underinvesting. So that's one thing. Another one is what's happening to spending on agricultural R&D. So in spite of what I just said about what rates of return imply, that we should be spending more, we're going in the wrong direction. So in the high-income countries in particular, there's been a slowdown in the rate of growth of spending on agricultural research, and that money is being spent on different things. So a diminishing share of the total is being spent on farm productivity growth enhancement. That's true particularly in the more developed countries, middle-income countries, particularly Brazil, China and India. It's a different story. And then productivity. We've heard quite a bit about this today, and I'm glad that more and more people are saying this now. I've been saying it for a long time, and it used to be hard to get people to listen. But it's become quite clear to many people now that there's been a substantial slowdown in the rate of growth of agricultural productivity. You'll still get people disagreeing about that. It's hard to measure, hard to be precise about it, but I think the picture's becoming clearer. And again, it's different in different parts of the world. So in China, India and Brazil, not as much of a slowdown as in the rich countries. And maybe it's a coincidence that those are the countries that are backing off from agricultural R&D support. So what are the implications? I think we need to do something differently if we're going to reinvigorate spending on agricultural R&D, particularly in the public sector. If we don't do that, there are some bad consequences in terms of the long term. Agricultural R&D takes a long time to affect productivity, then it affects it for a long time. And the long-term consequences of not doing enough are the world food supply and demand balance is different. We have more people poor and hungry in the world. We have more strife related to that. We have more pressure on the natural resource base. If we're the country that's relatively slow, we lose competitive capacity. Okay, that's my story. This is a summary of a meta-analysis we did about 10 years ago, a bit longer, summarising all the evidence in the literature on rates of return to research up until then. There's a lot of studies, nearly 300 studies, some of them estimated more than one rate of return, so we had 1,800 some estimates of rates of return, and the average of that was 82% per annum real. That's a pretty good rate of return. Now we think a lot of these estimates are probably biased up, but the answer is compelling. And the mass of that distribution lies between about 20 and 40% real rate of return. For people who invest, you'd be happy with that, I think. We've got some new evidence. This is a bit vainglorious, I'm sorry, but this is the best work in the area. I say that because it's my work. Well, it's the newest work. This book is called Persistence Pays, and that's for a reason. It took us 15 years. Working a fair bit of the time on this to generate it. So it's about the US, and it's interesting perhaps to people who aren't interested in the US because we have relatively good data in the US. So it's based on an analysis of over 100 years of detailed state-level data on agricultural research and extension spending, and the consequences of that for agricultural productivity in the 48 contiguous states measured using really wonderful data over the post-World War II period. And so we have lessons from that for the rest of the world, and we identify challenges in here, some of which Terry brought up in terms of modelling spillovers. Not the spillovers that people sometimes talk about with respect to environmental externalities or to other sectors. It's within the sector, but among spaces. So when Victoria does research, it generates benefits in Tasmania or New Zealand, and that affects Victoria's incentives to do research, and we have to account for that in modelling policy and in measuring the consequences of policy. The lags are really long. Our research, we had much better data, much longer series than most people. We could measure the lags, and they're much longer than most people think or much people have used in their models, and that matters for the measures. And then there's a role of maintenance research that's special for agricultural R&D. So in ecology, they talk about the Red Queen effect, which is the idea that when species co-evolve, you've got to work really hard just to break even with all the other species that are competing with you. And it applies in agriculture. So if we stopped doing research now, productivity wouldn't just stay where it is, it would fall, because pests and diseases get better. So when we're doing innovation in agriculture, we look at average yields and so forth, and we've got to deal with the fact that the location of production is changing, so we have to do adaptive research just to hold productivity constant in a new place. And because pests and diseases are evolving, we have to do maintenance research just to keep up with them. And it may be half or two-thirds of the total research spending is maintenance research. It's necessary just to hold productivity where it was. Okay. So we did this work on the United States, and this is summarizing, this is like the bottom line from the book. And looking in the first column, you see across the 48 states, the average benefit-cost ratio was 21 to 1 across the 48 states. That means you put down a dollar today, you get eventually benefits that are equivalent to $21 today. That's a really good return. I like that kind of investment. In addition to the $21 at home, you generate another $11 in other states. So the next number, 32.1 to 1, that's the national benefit cost ratio. That's really big. And there's a range across the states from 10 to 70 to 1. USDA research generates about 18 to 1. That's a really big benefit cost ratio. But we've done a better job than other people of dealing with all these awkward measurement problems. So even though our benefit cost ratios seem really big, our estimate of the internal rate of return is only around 20% per annum, down the low end of that middle, okay? So these are really wonderful investments, returning benefit cost ratios of 20, 30 to 1, with an internal rate of return of 20%, okay? Really good investments. Okay, this is total science spending in the United States. I'm using the US as a metaphor because we know a lot about it. So they're spending nearly $400 billion in 2008, agricultural science around 2% of that. You compare the food and agriculture sector versus total science, and there's a difference in how it's done. In the rest of the business, business has a lot to do with it, whereas in food and agriculture, there's a much bigger share of the private sector in the total. And that's because the nature of market failures in agriculture is different because of the structure of the industry. This is spending in the United States 1950 to 2009, and you can see it flattens out a bit, just like the Australian story, and private and public doing roughly equal amounts recently. In the private sector, quite a big share of that money is being spent on food processing. It's beyond the farm gate. We've got to keep that in mind. So I'm concerned about farm productivity, and the private sector is doing some of that, but it's doing a lot of stuff that isn't about that. This is looking at the growth rates of spending, and we can see there's been a slowdown in growth of spending, as Terry was talking about here. What's the money being spent on? So this is state agricultural experiment station research. Two-thirds or three-quarters of the total is done in state agricultural experiment stations, like the one where I work in California, and the rest done by the federal government in USDA labs. A lot of the money coming to the state agricultural experiment station comes from the USDA or other federal sources. And what this picture shows is that at the tail end, you see the federal share of total spending in the state experimentation going up since about 1980. But the USDA share of that's going down. So what's happening is where I work, we're getting a bigger share of our money from the federal government, but it's not from USDA. It's from National Science Foundation, Department of Energy, National Institutes of Health. They're not interested in funding farming research. So the farm productivity share of state agriculture experimentation research, this has got a crooked scale on this thing. It starts at 55%, not zero, okay? It hasn't fallen as far as it looks. So it was around 70% in 1984, and it's down below 57% now. So it's gone down. We've got this for every state. So we can see that the distribution, the top ones, 1976, had a mean of 65% on farm. And that mean has shifted down to 56%. So the whole distribution shifted to the left. And that's because there's much more interest in funding research into food safety, health and nutrition, environmental issues, things like that, rather than farm productivity. The world as a whole now, agricultural science is about 5% of the global science budget, and we can see that it's distributed around the world. Quite a big share comes from a small number of countries. So the United States does roughly 20% of the total, roughly half and half private and public investments in the United States. And this is a measure of intensity ratios, like what Terry was talking about, among different countries. And if you look on the left-hand picture, you can see that, and these are showing over time, going from the 70s, 80s, 90s, 2000s. So this intensity, research spending per dollar of output has gone up from, in the high-income countries, from 1 to 3%. In the low and middle-income countries, stayed around 0.5%. So there's quite a bit of variation among countries going up over time, but noticeably in the rich countries is where the private sector activity is. And so that matters if you care about people going hungry in the rest of the world. Looking at growth rates of this spending, and we can see a slowdown in growth of spending in everywhere really, but especially in the low and middle income countries. So now, last topic, productivity. There's another book from last year. This one, that first book you can buy. It's very expensive. I don't get significant royalties from it, so I don't care if you buy it. This one's free, so you can help yourself get it off the web. And this has got chapters on many countries talking about changing agricultural productivity patterns in the world. We wrote this book because we became concerned about this issue and wanted to find out whether what we were observing in the US and a couple of other places was more pervasive. If you don't like reading the whole book, even though it is free, you don't have to read the whole thing. You can get a summary in Choices magazine, where we picked out the main messages and had short articles on the main places where there were stories to tell. The main points of this is that there's evidence of a significant and pervasive slowdown in agricultural productivity growth since about 1990. There are some exceptions. China's a really important exception with faster growth. Former Soviet Union and Central European countries, the opposite. And we think in both cases, institutional reform had a part to play in that pattern. We use lots of different measures. So we use crop yields, which is a kind of partial productivity measure, production per unit of land or labour, and a small number of places we have good multi-factor productivity measures, like what Terry was showing us. We have them for Australia, Canada, the US and the UK. And they all show the same general story. There's a consistency between the patterns. In a place like the US where multi-factor productivity growth has slowed down a bit, crop yield growth has slowed down quite a bit too.